Is the mic working? Yeah? Okay. So, should I say good morning? I don't know if it is a particularly good morning, but greetings to you all. Many of you won't know who I am. My name is Kavita Singh. I teach at the School of Arts and Aesthetics, and I haven't really been a face that is known to crowds like this because I have kept below the radar for most of my time in JNU. But unfortunately, for the last 6 months, I've been the dean of our school. And I've been forced into a position where I've had to attend meetings in which I've had to witness processes where I cannot keep being the kind of person that I was or keep working and functioning in the way that I did. I just want to say that the things that I have witnessed and the things that I have begun to anticipate, I think, say something very grave about the future for all of us. And I mean this for all of us who are on the left, on the center, as well as on the right. I mean it for now, and I mean it also for a future time when perhaps the dispensations will change and there will be other people in charge of the administration, because precedents will have been set and a manner of decision making will have been arrived at, which is going to affect all of us in profound, significant ways. And I cannot imagine an authority of any color or stripe that will not want to take advantage in the future of a precedent that is being set now. So even those who think that they are profiting from and benefiting from the current dispensation should know that there are bad days that are potentially being plan for them in the things that they are participating in now. So this is really something that all of us have to feel concerned about. So I want to just say that my first experience of being a dean was a sense of being thrown into a chaotic whirlwind where every day there were these circulars or these orders that would come which seemed to have absolutely no sense or thinking behind them, to which we would have to accede immediately, and which would throw us into a tailspin or a frenzy of work for new policies which we hadn't been, you know, apprised of, or the wisdom of which we did not know. And of course, behind the scenes, what would happen would be that somebody would challenge these things perhaps, so there would be a rethinking about it, and a week later whatever we had done the previous week would have to be undone and redone in another way. Now this is just on a very banal level of everyday functioning of the university. But for me the big shocks came when I had to attend the academic council meeting, and I have only attended one in my capacity as the dean, the 144th one, and then I received the minutes of that AC meeting. And then I attended the court meeting that followed the AC meeting. So the AC meeting was a complete shock to me, because I remembered as an associate professor when I had joined the university, I had attended meetings in that capacity, and it was a place of very vigorous discussion. And I remember even our school's proposals were criticized and we were told to revise them and come back with a revised plan, and we took that in good grace, even if we felt that the criticisms we were getting were not coming from people who understood our discipline. We took it in good grace as the view of the house, and we revised our proposals and came back and presented them at the next meeting. This time I was surprised even by the physical configuration of the space in the AC, because all of us were sitting in the auditorium, but the powers that be were sitting on the dais, and there were two peons who were patrolling the aisles with a mic each, and they were giving the mics to people selectively. I kept putting up my hand to raise questions, and the mic never came to me. When I asked the peon who was near me, "Bhaiya, mujhe mic do," he said, "Nahi, wo daantte hain. If we give it to anyone we're not supposed to give it to, we get scolded." They were not allowed to give the mic. The method of discussion was also very interesting, because even though the mic was being handed out very selectively to people, sometimes in an unanticipated way, the person who got the mic would turn out to be a dissenter or would have an objection to make. And then what would happen is that as quickly as possible, the mic would be taken away. And the way our Vice Chancellor chaired the meeting was that after the dissents were sounded, even while dozens of us were still waving our hands and asking to be seen and heard, he would say, all right, your opinion has been noted. The decision has been taken. We will move on to the next agenda. And he never articulated what the decision was. I even raised my hand, and when I didn't get the mic, I tried to shout out, sir, what is the decision? Because one had the sense that one was participating in something, and yet the thing that you are participating in is completely opaque to you, because you don't know what is being recorded out of the discussions that have happened. Sure enough, the worst that one could have expected from a meeting that is being conducted in this way gets confirmed when you receive the minutes, where bad though the meeting was, the minutes are degrees worse than the meeting, because the minutes seem to record unanimous agreement about things about which there was no agreement, about which there was no discussion, things that were not even brought up in the House. So it was like a piece of fiction when one was reading the minutes. One couldn't recognize them. It was a bizarre experience. And of course, many of us wrote notes of dissent about many points in the minutes. I have no idea what happens to these. It's a bit like going to a well and throwing a coin and wishing for luck. Writing to the administration is like that, because the letters just go in and no reply comes out. Then we go to the court meeting, and the court meeting was at another level of bizarreness, because even things that had been misrepresented in the minutes of the Academic Council meeting are further misrepresented in the minutes, where the Vice Chancellor is claiming to the people who have assembled even things that go beyond what the minutes have misrepresented. So it was just like a very, very strange experience for me, which left me very alarmed about the nature of decision making and what kinds of decisions can be claimed in the name of these meetings that are supposed to have been held. I was, of course, with all of you, very startled by the circulars that started coming about the attendance agreement, in which all of the circulars began by saying, as has been approved by the AC and the EC, these are the rules of mandatory attendance that are going to be in place. We know, those of us who attended the AC, that the matter was not discussed. And those of us who get these emails from the administration also know that an EC was scheduled. And then we got an email on the morning that the EC was scheduled saying that the EC had been postponed. I have not received any email about the email about the EC subsequently having been held. I have not received any minutes of any such EC which may have been held without my knowledge. And yet it is the authority of the AC and the EC which are being invoked for these rules that are being imposed on the university, which has put us in such turmoil. So I am really alarmed by the kinds of processes that have been put in place for decision making. Now, let me tell you how this method of, you know, producing minutes and fabricating entire meetings is playing out. Because I went for a meeting recently, which was about a non-contentious matter. It was about some kinds of scholarships. It was a small meeting with a small group of us. And one of the officials who seems to be doing pretty much everything in the university was sitting next to me. And I asked him whether the 9B students would be eligible for that particular scholarship. And he said, 9B to hai nahi. And I said, what do you mean? And he said, we have abolished 9B. There's going to be no more 9B year. They have to complete their PhDs in 4 years now. I don't know whether he said 3 or 4. And I said, when was this decided? And he said, it will be decided at the next AC. If we allow this kind of decision making to continue, if we allow all the procedures and the institutions that are in place of decision making to continue, can you begin to imagine what our lives are going to be? I want to just tell you what I have observed and intuited from the experience of the AC and the court meeting of what might happen to all of us by taking the example of a proposal that was made by the SPS, the School of Physical Sciences, where the dean had made a proposal for introducing a master's in mathematics. Now, apparently she had tried to table this in the previous AC, which I did not attend, the previous dean attended. And apparently at that meeting, the dean of SPS was told that she has to get the consent or the opinion of the entire university community whether or not she should introduce an MSc in mathematics. So the matter was deferred to the next meeting. About a week or so before the AC meeting that I attended, I got an email from her saying that we were all supposed to send in our views about this MSc in mathematics, and so would we please urgently do so because it has to be tabled in the meeting. I think all of us wrote in support of the introduction of this MSc. When the matter came to the AC, it was not on the agenda. So when the time came for any other item to be introduced, this dean again tried to introduce the matter, and she was told it is not time. So she asked why it was not time to introduce it yet, and she was told that the opinions that you have got, which are overwhelmingly in her support, but the opinions that she has got have come into the administration only a few days before the AC, and therefore that was too little time for them to consider the matter of whether the MSc should be introduced or not. Meanwhile, of course, other matters are being tabled at the meeting, which are not already in the preformed agenda. It's perfectly valid to discuss them. But this, for some reason, cannot be brought to the table, and she's told that we'll consider it the next time. A couple of weeks later, we have the court meeting. And at the court meeting, this poor persistent dean again raises her hand in front of the court. And she says, I want to bring up the issue of the introduction of the MSc in mathematics. The administration tries to shut her down by saying this is not the forum in which to introduce this. But she persists and she says, I want to know why I can't table this matter, why it cannot be discussed. And at that point, our vice chancellor, who is silent most of the time, suddenly, you know, the emotion wells up and he's impelled to speak. And he very testily says to her that, why are you insisting on this MSc in mathematics? You know that physics and mathematics is very important for our engineering students as well. Who is going to teach them their basic courses when they come, because we don't have any faculty in place? You cannot do this at this time. He also told her that you are the only dean who is not in the sciences, who has not written in support of my engineering, and therefore you cannot expect support from me. He says this on the dais in front of the university court. Right? Please just reflect on this for a moment. And those of you who are not in the sciences, please reflect on the fact that the engineering degree that is planned is going to be a joint degree in engineering and social sciences. And please be very aware of what role we are all going to be conscripted into, where we are all going to have our own programs whittled down so that we can teach these undergraduates in engineering who are being invited into the university. You know, if we are going to not be able to participate in decision making, we are going to have no control over even those small areas of autonomy which make our lives worthwhile. It is something very, very serious that we are faced with. These are only some of the things that I can see and intuit from participating in two meetings. Others might know other things, and there may be yet other things that are to be revealed to us. But if we don't take charge now, it's going to be a never.